like bears. Oh my gosh, I don't know, I love bears. So if you take the whole, what is a bear good for? A bear is very beneficial to the ecology. They eat a lot of grass, but they also eat carrion, so they clean up. They're amazing social intelligent animals that can problem solve and adapt. And also, they're one of my favorite animals to hunt. If I could honestly live on free range meat that's been happy all of its life, I love bear.
I think we can go ahead and get started. Thank you all very much for coming. We've got Black Bear Happenings in New Hampshire set with Brenda Leary, one of the New Hampshire Fish and Wildlife.
Fish and Game,
representative. So we're very stoked to have her. We've got a few of these programs coming up still in this summer series. Next week, we've got the invasive upland plant species presentation. That's going to be on Tuesday night as well. So don't be sure to miss that. At the back of the room, she's got a few informational booklets as well, so be sure to see those at the end of the presentation. So,
and there's two books up here that belong to the library that you can check out. All of the other pamphlets are just samples, and feel free to look through them, but just please leave them at the end tonight.
Also, be aware, today we're recording this for the Lakes Region Public Access, so that'll be on TV, you can view it later. And we'll also throw it up on YouTube. It'll be on the Guilford Library website. So just be aware of that. Thank you very much, Brenda.
Thank you. Welcome, guys. Like I said, my name is Brenda Leary. I am a Fish and Game officially trained steward. We have some classroom time, and I was trained by Andy Timmons, who is the New Hampshire Fish and Game biologist. We're going to be talking about bears. So part of this program is sponsored by the Wildlife Restoration Fund. What does that mean? How is that important? Approximately 11% tax on things such as tackle, guns, archery equipment. And have you ever noticed that if you have a boat, it's more expensive for gas on the docks than it is, say, at the gas station? That's because the fuel tax goes to this, the Wildlife Restoration Fund. It is extremely important. Approximately $6 to $7 million is turned over to the state of New Hampshire for funds for wildlife management, for habitat construction, for things such as the boat ramp constructions and maintenance. Here's an example of a lot of the wildlife that you will find here in New Hampshire. We have the fisher, the cougar. Well, he's not really a resident of New Hampshire. He can be occasionally a migrant wanderer. We have our martens, bald eagles, foxes, snowshoe hare, turkey, the deer, the bear, got a little river otter, beaver, the bobcat, and the brook trout. Now, if you imagine in the 1700s, when the Europeans first came here, there was a ton of resources, things that they didn't see in Europe anymore. The fur, that was stuff that in Europe had already been depleted. So they came to this new world, and there was an abundance of food, of animals, of lumber and timber, and they just went at it. And quickly, very quickly, in the mid-1700s, they started to realize that there was a huge decline in these animals. If you close your eyes and you think, what do you hear the first thing in the morning? You hear all the songbirds coming alive? Almost all of the songbirds were completely hunted to almost extinction. Beaver hats. Do you know that between 1750 and 1900, there were zero beavers in the state of New Hampshire? They had all been hunted and killed, trapped for their fur, for pelts, for their hats, coats, really long fur. This is what New Hampshire looked like. 80% deforested. Today, it's 80% forested. there's been a huge turnaround. So we had a couple of really high profile people, and in 1937, they realized that they were going to have a major problem if they didn't stop. So they had this act passed. It's called the Pittman-Robinson Act, or the PR Act, and that has really changed everything on conservation and management. So the buffalo used to look like, now, I guess if you're lucky, you might see them running down the bypass, but there are definitely no more bison running around, and out west, they've had to do a lot to conserve them. So again, 11% of tax. You don't see that. You don't pay 11% tax on top of what you pay. It is manufacturers, they have to pay that, and it kind of just rolls over in the overall cost. Fishing licenses, fishing license, hunting license, trapping license, those funds go directly to fish and game, and then they turn around and they reuse that funds for management, for law enforcement, for rescues. These are some of the projects that Pittman Act cover. So you got that $6 to $7 million that's in the budget, and anything that has to do with enhancing wildlife, whether it's for birds or mammals. Also the public use, that's huge. We have one right down here in town, Salt Marsh Pond. There's a boat ramp there that is maintained by New Hampshire Fish and Game. So that is the tax money from the sales of tackle, guns and stuff, and gas, plus the fishing licenses come together to support that boat ramp. Mm-hmm. So some of that. So that's basically what the Wildlife Restoration Fund is. Now we're gonna talk more about some of our animals. As you guys know, the moose, they have faced a lot of challenges in the past 5 years. Turkeys were eliminated from New Hampshire. This is a really good example of restoration and reintroduction. How many of you guys have seen a turkey this week? Right? Just about everybody saw a turkey. Can you imagine? A couple hundred years ago, they didn't exist. I think they were introduced in the 1970s. Just look how far they have come. And we have some programs also like Berry Camp and Owl Brook, which we teach youth how to shoot safely. There we go. Here's our black bear. Ursus americanus. That is our black bear that we have here. Their diet. Okay, quick trivia question. How many people think that bear eat a ton of meat, like insects, fish? How many people think more vegetables like grasses and berries? You are right. They are what is called an omnivore. So they eat both vegetation and they eat meat. They will eat insects and they will eat carrion. However, black bear do not often fish. This is where the black bear are currently distributed. As you can see, all over here. New Hampshire. We have black bear in all 11 counties. We have black bear in all of our towns, in all of our cities in New Hampshire. Prime habitat. You've got some forests, and you've got a little bit of grass on the end, and you've got this wetland. Bears need water, especially in the spring. The wetlands are usually the first ones to start melting. Those produce or provide tubers, grasses, and sedge for the bears to start eating. Berries. How many of you guys have seen the berry season this year? Blueberries like galore. I went to the top of Mount Major the other day and you would not believe the piles of wild animals get. And it was all blueberries. There's bears get, coyotes get. It is a great season for berries. Acorns, We've got some white oak and red oak. That's a red oak. White oak actually has a lot more nutrients for both the deer, the turkey, and the bears. Pound per pound, a white oak is just fabulous food. And then your beech nuts. They love this buffer. So bears do love the woods. A lot of you have probably, if you guys have gone out hiking or walking, probably didn't realize it, but a bear was probably watching you at one point or another. They do like to kind of look out and know what's going on. This is a classic example of a den. So the funny thing about bears, some of them will find a turned over root section. You know how like when a tree falls over, you got the roots that exposed, and they might come in and tunnel that all out. But there have also been instances where, especially like a big male bear, kind of find a spot on the forest floor and say, this looks good. Just kind of pops down. Even if the snow falls on him, no big deal. He goes into semi-hibernation. I've heard stories of people hiking or going with their dogs and all of a sudden finding a bear standing there in the middle of the woods. It's because he denned down. He just denned down a little bit of leaves. Breeding season. They like to breed in around September. And then the babies are born in late January to early February. And they are very cute. But as you guys can see, they're pretty helpless. He's blind, he's powerless, and he definitely can't be walking around and crawling around. They are very, very small. And they are in the den with mom, and she nurses and feeds them until approximately March and April when they start coming out. What can happen is if you have a weird winter and it warms up too fast, things can disturb the dens. Dogs can disturb the dens. People, loggers, if logging starts too early, and then what can happen is you can actually have these bears this young and they start getting calls at fishing game that there's abandoned bears. A big problem. You can see the difference from that little bear. They're still in the den with her at that size. They're nice, healthy bears. And then they are cubs, mommy bear. They're getting a lot bigger. They stay with her approximately 18 months. So this slide here is a little bit old. I have the updated slide if anybody would like to look at it. Our populations look at 90s and 94. We had almost just a little over 3,000 there. Honestly, now they're closer to the 6,000. And they want to keep them around the 5,500 range. That's a very healthy population. And they have the bear population broken down by region. White Mountains, Lakes region, further south, and what their goals are. They put a lot of effort into studying the bears. Fish and Game, they honestly care about the animals and giving them the best environment, the best living situation. So they take data from hunters and roadkill, and occasionally when they radio collar the bears, and they get a lot of data. So that was the breakdown that I was talking about. And again, I have the updated version in here if anyone is interested. So this was basically their goal for this past year. I have the data to say whether they have met it or not. The north, the population up north is actually a lot higher. And there's been some high profile cases in the past couple of months of northern bears on the troublesome. So one of the things that New Hampshire Fish and Game does, and also the USDA, it's a co-op. They work together and they manage these wildlife problems. And as you can see, it breaks down what our nuisance calls are in the state of New Hampshire. We have calls like Canadian geese from golf courses and football fields. Birds, I mean, birds aren't porcupines, porcupine strip bark off of trees, beaver flooding, but still, you're only at 4%. Woodchuck, raccoon, coyote, look at how low those numbers are. 31% of all complaints are about bears. This is the breakdown, agricultural. So you're talking about farms, places that have chickens and bees and make a profit, and then people that, their residences. And you can see clearly what the breakdown of nuisance calls. So this year, as I was saying to some of you guys when you walked in, and honestly, this is one of the main goals of this program, is to educate so that we can minimize bear-human conflicts. So, the bird seed and trash. That's just population statistics. This gives a little bit of the breakdown again. 80% forested is what the estimate is in New Hampshire. So we have been losing about 17,500 acres annually. Again, like I said, those bears can get quite comfy next to humans. Look at that. What mommy is doing here is not only is she eating food, this is the best high quality food that you can possibly get as a bear. It's natural, so high in protein and fat, but it doesn't exist naturally. We don't have vast fields of sunflowers just growing in New Hampshire. She's teaching her little bear cubs how to get food. Thing about bears, they're very intelligent and they really forget. That trash, again, there is nothing like trash to a bear. It's fantastic. You got meat, you get pies, I mean, donuts. Man, a lot of those places, you get a day-old donut, it goes in the trash, and man, they just love that stuff. Fish, meat, scraps, they love it. Look at that. Oh my word, you say, who would do that? Did anyone read the article about last month about the family that was feeding bears?
And they have been for years.
They have been here. Right here in New Hampshire, and they have been feeding them for years. I'll talk a little bit about that later. That is not a good thing. That is a very bad thing. And as cute and awesome as it is, if they catch you doing it, you will get a pretty big fine. Now look at that. There are 5 cubs. That's not normal. Mama bear, she's huge. No mama bear does. She raised the trash, and she raised the bird feeders. So biologically, a mother bear will produce cubs depending on her fat stores and what kind of food she has had the fall before. It is incredibly unnatural for a bear to have 5 cubs. There was just an incident this spring where there were 5 bear cubs, and a conservation officer came, and they kept calling because the bear wouldn't leave the roadway, and he was actually able to come up and grab, I believe he grabbed 2 cubs right from her, and she was fine with it. As he grabbed the second cub, she just turned and walked away with the other 3. The theories were is that she somehow realized that she was going to get help from the humans, and she stayed there until she got help from the humans, and then they haven't had a problem with her since. But that 1 or 2 cubs did end up in rehab. Way too close to humans. Yep. Any of you guys in Guilford lost bird feeders to a bear? Yep. Bird feeders need to come down. They're so cute. But they're right in the backyard. They're supposed to be afraid. They're supposed to be like, oh, human, I'm going to hightail it out of here. Now, this is going to bring it into reality. Who likes to see that? Now, that bear's life has been completely, pretty much wasted. He is not going to get eaten. He is not going to go into a hunter's freezer. This was a bear that walked into a house, looks like dog food. He could smell human food. He was not afraid of humans. A bear should never want to approach a garage or a house. He came into a house and there were people inside. And luckily the person had a gun and was able to shoot him. But you corner a bear in something like a house and you create a dangerous situation. There are two things that you never want to do, ever, or three. You never want to stand between a bear and a food supply. You never want to corner a bear. And you never want to stand between cubs and a bear. And unfortunately, this is a very bad situation. So there are several options. And one is just directly controlling. You go to a campground, you lock your food up, you either hang it from a tree, put it in a bear box, a lot of campgrounds have bear boxes, or you lock it in your car. Harvesting. Hunting is one of those fine lines. Some people absolutely hate it, some people love it. Scientifically, there's a balance. They find that legal harvest is one of the most sustainable practices for bear management. There is. Bear education. This is why I'm here. When I heard about what had happened in Hanover with the three bear cubs and the mother, it kind of broke my heart. Because now you've got these animals that are supposed to be in the wild, and they're being set up for failure by human beings. It is preventable. Abatement, fences, fish and game, and the USDA co-op that I was talking to you about, they have programs available to farmers. They even have programs available to you guys. If you were to, say, have beehives or chicken coops, and you kept getting bears that came in them, they have an electric fence borrowing program where they will help you, they will let you try out some electric fencing, and then you can decide, you know, okay, this is how it works, I'm gonna go buy my own, and they come and collect the fencing. Assistance, again, fish and game, the USDA. There's the co-op, I know that the UNH cooperative will offer some assistance. Those are all places that you can call for more information. Compensation, if the bears do come and destroy your beehives or your crops or your chickens, they can come in and do an investigation and they can actually issue you a refund if you qualify. So these are some of the pamphlets that Fish and Game has. I don't know, have any of you guys been to the New Hampshire Fish and Game headquarters in Concord? It is right in Hazen, on Hazen Drive, right next to the DMV, and they have a whole bunch of literature in there. They have books, they have a discovery center downstairs. One of the things they do in April around Earth Day is they have Wild New Hampshire Day. They have a ton of publications. You can call them, ask them to mail, you can go down and grab some of these brochures. See this everywhere. As a big hiker, this placard is often posted right onto trailheads, campgrounds. And it is a fact, garbage does kill bears. If the bears are allowed to eat the garbage and they start interacting with people, they will be euthanized. You never ever want to feed the bear. You want to make sure that your food is stored properly. Especially in backcountry, I do a lot of shelter camping that's put on by like the AMC, and they have their huts or their shelters are in one place, and then your cooking area is completely separate. And then again, that minimizes, all right, so maybe there's a trace of smell of food. They stay there, they stay away from humans. You always wanna keep your dog leashed, especially if you know there's a high bear population. Respect its space. And then here it says right here, what do you do if you encounter a bear? You remain standing. Maintain a non-threatening eye contact. You back away softly. You speak in a soft, confident voice. Do not run. Do not climb trees. And then if you do truly encounter kind of a pain in the butt bear, you want to report it. those bird feeders. So this here, in Guilford, it's not as big of a problem. When you get up to North Country, dumpsters are huge. They just go right in. Think about it, most of our dumpsters just have a plastic door or plastic flip that a bear can flip that in 5 seconds and be right in there. But as you can see right up here, that's all steel. Here's a barrel that's latched down. The top of that dumpster is latched with a bar. Same thing with this. I have a couple I clean. A couple of our contracts in Center Harbor have dumpsters just like that with latches. If you have a problem with bear and you have bear-proof dumpsters, make sure you latch them. They get these half cables and ties that do not allow the bear. Just simple clips that they can't open. So this here is some noisemakers that they use. There's rubber bullets, and then there's just blanks that make a lot of noise. Some people, farmers, and other people use to scare away the bears. Beehives, they love honey. All right, who doesn't love honey? So sweet and full of calories. They don't care if they get stung. They don't care. It does not bother them. So there we go, we got the electric pets. Hunters, again, this is a legal hunter and a legal bear. That's a pretty good sized bear. But again, you know, he looks really big. That guy, I would estimate he's probably about 300 pounds. This is a bear trap. Have any of you guys seen Northwoods Law? The New Hampshire edition? They caught one of these. I believe this is, I don't remember how they captured the Hanover bears, but I think they had a couple of these in Hanover. The problem is if you really have a nuisance bear, they can cover miles. They can cover 25 miles like nothing. Now, really, where can you drop a bear off in the center of New Hampshire that you can't go 25 miles without finding more people? So they'll take a nuisance bear, and a lot of it is people squawking, don't kill the bear, don't, you know, petitioning the governor, let's not do this, let's relocate him. But if it's truly a nuisance bear, he's going to be somebody else's nuisance. So important to prevent this nuisance problem. There are rules and ordinances, Lincoln, Franconia, Gorham, Bethlehem. I know that after this high profile case, the governor was trying to work on having more ordinances. And honestly, those ordinances have to do with garbage, trash, and bird feeders. And people can get cited if you don't have your trash secured and you don't have your bird feeders in. You can see this is complaints when the ordinance is just some statistics. And research. So this, the fish and game biologists go out, they're highly trained. Andy Timmons is our bear biologist, and they do radio collar. They usually have some safety features that if they were to get caught on something, they would break away. They send a lot of data. The little cup is tagged. They encourage us as hunters that if we see a tagged or a radio collared bear, pass on the shop. So this was statistics and then radio. This was in the Lincoln area. It was 11 and a half year old female, and the tracking was from July to, is that September, October? 99 days. So this is where they where they plotted her. You can see this is like her center and how far she goes up. So this is, again, the nuisance bear. Persistent nuisance bears tended to be resident bears, often females. Again, they're feeding themselves for their cubs. It was just a couple of bears that were the same repeat offenders. Again, hunting would be great if you could say, hey, that's the nuisance bear, but it doesn't always work that way. problem bears. Look at somebody's grill. I mean, somewhere, you're talking right off the deck. There's the bears. I don't know why we're king size. Okay. There are hounds. Those are probably hunting dogs. So this was another study. The green is where the dumpsters are, household garbage, where the bears are, and the bird feeders. You can see how they're clustered. They cluster around their food source. I mean, they're not stupid. They're incredibly smart, intelligent animals. They know where the good food is. Then more statistics. So they found that the rubber buckshot moved the bears for short periods of time, but they always came back. Hounds moved them for a longer period of time, but guess what? All problem bears ended up returning.
But if you haul one off, let's say, to get rid of them, they always come back.
They don't always come back to that spot, but they find that they often become a nuisance bear in that next spot. I don't remember what the exact statistics were. I know that they were published recently again in the Hanover case. So this is, again, this is a lot of data. I'm not sure you guys, anyone really super interested in data? One of the things that a lot of people don't understand about is bear baiting. I've talked about it a lot. In New Hampshire, it is legal to bait bear. And a lot of people go, how is that fair? You take out the natural hunting and pursuit. Unfortunately, bears are very hard to hunt in their natural habitat. Bear baiting is what makes hunting efficient. They have rules, like you can't feed them chocolate. They want like berries and nuts, and occasionally a donut or two. Honey, molasses. Even with bear baiting, there are a ton of bears that will not come to the bait. They just won't. They won't come down. Back on that other one. Where did it go? Okay. So what you are looking at here, they are trying to get data from the bear. So without tranquilizing him, they have this little rope out, and then they have food. So every time a bear goes into the area, a little bit of fur gets caught and it gets pulled out of the root. And there you go, see the bear hair? And they can do scientific testing on it. A lot of the testing is done at UNH by students and interns. You see that packaging out? Isn't he beautiful? It's gorgeous. Again, Alrighty, does anyone have any bear questions? Again, I am not a biologist.
I have a question.
Sure.
Way back, you said if you saw a bear when you were on the trail, that you should make eye contact?
Yes, that's what
they're finding.
That's what they're finding. That's what their studies are. I know that I've had a couple of close encounters with bears. It scared me at first. But then when I started to become more educated, it was classic bear behavior. So one of the things that a bear will do if it's startled, it'll kind of really quickly drop down and it'll huff and puff and like blow out its cheeks at you. And that's called a bluff. It might even false charge you, where it might rush, stop, and then usually they take off. And that is just classic bear behavior. So if you're coming across the down trail and there's a bear, he didn't see you, you didn't see him, just be like, oh, hey buddy, it's okay, and then just back away. No running, no jumping up trees, don't be aggressive. That was kind of my mistake. I didn't realize that when I got into my close encounter, I didn't realize it was a bear. I was just doing something I wasn't supposed to do, and I didn't realize it was the bear, so I, in a very deep voice, went, get! It didn't really like that. It kind of took it as a challenge. It dropped down. It bluffed. It was very dark. I realized it was a bear, and I realized it was right there. So I did the high-pitched, girly scream thing. let me tell you, it was like, what is that?
Bear spray. I mean, that's a very popular thing to use, isn't it?
I don't like bear spray. I would never carry it. I don't know if
I mean, out west, they use it.
Yes. Yes. Absolutely. I have no information whatsoever on anybody really needing bear spray. Again, anytime that there has been a bear attack recently, there are usually scratches or some bites, not mauls, but bites. And it's typically somebody who is trying to take a bird feeder away from the bear. That's usually what it is. You never want to take the food away from a bear who's trying to eat it.
So in other words, waving your arms and yelling isn't the thing to do.
That is not what they're... That's not what the New Hampshire officials encourage people to do for the New Hampshire black bear. Not for the black bear here in New Hampshire. Just stay calm. Just about any animal that you may encounter in New Hampshire, you just want to kind of stay calm. Hey, buddy, and just back away.
What about bear bells? Have you heard of that?
I use bear bells.
Okay.
I do a lot of hiking. I do a lot of trail running. It's a constant jingle. The bear, most animals are very keen on hearing and their environment, what's a normal sound. And the jingling of that bell will definitely warn them that there's probably a human coming. It eliminates that startle factor. I clap too sometimes. Especially, I sometimes go out around dusk, and that's not just bear, but a lot of critters are feeding. And I'm fine, you know, I'm not terrified of anything, but I don't want to be alone on a trail face to face with just about any kind of mammal by myself at dusk. Yeah.
So, a few years ago, it was spring, I remember early lake, there was a lot of snow, and I'm snowshoeing off the trail with my dog, and he was circling this tree, and I'm like, what are you doing?
Ooh.
And I looked up, and bit as high as the ceiling was, it's a little cub.
Yes.
And so I was like, oh. And I just kind of just talked to my dog calmly and kept on going, but I was waiting for the mama bear to, I never saw the bear.
Yeah.
I don't know.
So there are several things that you just identified. There was still snow on the ground and it was early spring. So bears are not true hibernators. They can wake up and go back to sleep. They also have this defense that if they're found in their den, they get very, very drowsy, but they can come out of their hibernation or their semi-hibernation like this and defend themselves. So your dog may go ahead, and that bear may have enough time to go up the tree. A cub may have enough time to go up the tree, but they're in a semi-stupor. And like I said, it is very common when things start to thaw for a bear to come out and feed for a little bit and to go back down and rest.
So is the mom still in the den? Did the little ones come
out? Could have been.
It depends
how big it was. Yeah, she was probably, they were probably still, they could have been drowsy, you know. And then, she's pretty protective, but they're curious.
Should I have gone back the way I came?
Just getting your dog out and doing what you did was fine. You never really want to disturb them, especially in that crucial time from late February to May. You never want to have a female abandon her cubs. Fishing game often does everything they possibly can to save the cubs, but it's a lot of work. I have a book back there. There's a guy I was telling you guys about, Ben Killam, and he is the top provider of rehabilitation for young bears. They find that older bears cannot be rehabilitated. Another really interesting bear fact is that when bears go into their semi-hibernation, they form what's called a fecal plug. And it's a plug of stool that doesn't come out until they are ready to get up full time for the spring. So even though they may come out and forage a little bit, they still do not urinate or defecate. They do not urinate or defecate in their dens. They do not urinate or defecate for months. And I think the theory is that that holds everything in and their body reabsorbs things. It's kind of an amazing thing about a bear.
Mm-hmm. You may have talked to this before I arrived, but what was the incident in Hanover?
Okay, so it hasn't been part of our training, but I've been following what happened in Hanover. There was a complaint from homeowner that there was a mother bear and I believe three cubs that had entered his dwelling. When Fish and Game came and did a little bit of research, they found out he did not have any bird feeders. He secured his trash. Somehow, the bear smelled food inside. There was a screen wind door that the bear finagled and opened, and the bear walked into the residence with her cubs while there were people inside. I believe there were children, a wife, and a father inside. And that is a huge problem. That is an incident that almost always results in euthanization. It became a very high profile case when Fish and Game made the statement that they were looking for this bear, the whole family, and they were gonna euthanize it. Animal rights groups from across the country and the governor got involved, and they essentially petitioned Fish and Game and they stopped. They did, some of the biologists and some very dedicated volunteers went out, I believe, Mother's Day or Memorial Day weekends, and they were able to capture, I believe, mom and two of the cubs, and they were able to radio collar them and release them. I believe at this point they have not heard of any complaints about these bears. Those bears were incredibly lucky. They were going to be sentenced for death row. There was a lot of anger from animal rights groups, and then there was a lot of evidence from scientists. When it all came down, they said this could have been prevented. This never needed to happen. And again, this is the biggest goal of this program, this particular program.
Wasn't there also a couple in that area who had been feeding the bears and attracting the bears to that area?
I believe that was a completely separate town.
Oh, was it separate?
Mm-hmm. And that man, I believe, I read the article, I believe the man was and his wife were convinced that they were helping the bears. And when they came in, and again, it was a press thing, so there's been no official training from Fish and Game on our part. But when you looked at the press article, there were a lot of complaints from the neighbors. A lot of the neighbors had children and pets, and their children would be out on the swings. And these bears would come down because they knew at an approximately certain time, Mr. and Mrs. would come out with buckets of lard and bacon, berries, whatever. And they would just move through the neighborhood. And then people with their kids on swings would be like, bears. People started to be afraid to leave their animals out, their children out. It changed the neighborhood. The neighborhood became fearful. And again, bears are not supposed to exist with humans.
Do you have any experience like out west with, you mentioned brown bear, grizzlies, any?
Me personally?
or just some knowledge?
I know that they're a lot bigger, they're a lot stronger, they're a lot more aggressive. I went to Yellowstone as a young adult, and I was able to see a grizzly in person. It was amazing. I had taken down an elk. Think about how large an elk is, okay? An elk is around our moose size, and this bear took it down and was going to town eating it. Now, once you hear about a grizzly feeding and stopping in these places like Yellowstone, it becomes broadcasted. Here's the bear. Everybody starts and drives there. Everybody wants to see a grizzly bear. And I remember they had, I believe, I'm not sure if the agency, if it was Forest or National Guard, but there was a helicopter behind us with two guys with fully automatic rifles standing there with a park ranger in the front. It's safe now, but if we give the word, you get in your car. and I mean, it was amazing, but they're a lot more powerful, a lot more dangerous.
Did you use a bear keg when you camped there?
We were in Girl Scouts, and we never were backcountry. But yes, if you're ever interested in traveling backcountry, they have manufacturers of all kinds of bear kits, and they really, they're odor-proof, and you don't want bears. Even in New Hampshire, you do not want bears around your food at a campground.
Would a beer bell help you out there if you had bells on?
I think they encourage it anyway, again, so you don't startle them. Mm-hmm. They sell collars even here in New Hampshire. You can find them with the bear bells on the dog's collars so that your dogs don't startle the bears in the woods. I know that. It depends. I used to, before I knew as much as I knew about bears, I was kind of afraid of them. So I used to have a bear bell on my walking stick, and when I went out in the middle of the night, so go to the bath, and I'd be like, jingle, 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 hey bear!
When bear moves in the brush, they move fairly, I mean, for the most part, slowly, but does it sound brush-like? Like,
we
saw deer, they seem to move fast. I just heard something, it was just this weekend when I was up near the blueberries, and it was a big animal, you could tell, and it just sounded so different. I said to my friend, I really think that's a bear. Let's just keep going, you know.
Yeah,
it just had a different sound.
So, it really depends. When I hunt, and I have never got my own bear, but my friends have, and I've helped be part of the process. The bear's paws are most like ours. Each one is kind of shaped like ours. And they walk very quietly. They have big, thick, fatty pads, and they typically walk very softly and very carefully. But I have also heard stories of hunters were saying, the bear just didn't really care, and it was moving with purpose, crunch, 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 crunch. So it depends on what kind of mood the bear is. Honestly, I've been in the woods and been like, oh, what's that coming? It's gotta be huge. And you know, you're ready?
Yeah.
And then it comes in and it's the smallest of birds. And you're like, how does something that small make that much noise? I swear it was a monster. So I can't answer without any extra clues. It is blueberry season and you have your squirrels. They are so noisy. They're like the monsters of the woods, you call them. Close your eyes for a second and go, that's a monster. I'm convinced there's a monster. Yes?
Do the bears go after the chickens or the feed from the chicken?
Chickens. They will eat chickens.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. You have to really secure your, if you have problem bears around chickens, you have to secure your coop. You have to make sure that it is secure enough that a bear can't get on it. Push it down. There have been cases where the bear has kind of been like, oh, look, chicken, I know this trick. They'll push the coop, chain link, whatever, right on the bird. They'll kill the bird. They'll kind of like move the fence, grab the bird and eat it.
We had an instance, we live on Irish Center Lane in a house, a family from us, maybe 10 homes away. They have chickens, we don't, but and we have a dog, but we have a brook in our yard, and we kept seeing white feathers, and then we put two and two together that it must be the chicken. Would a bear take the chicken and go eat it by the brook, possibly? Or a coyote, or what would do that?
It could have been anything. Weasels. Weasels love chickens.
But isn't a weasel smaller?
There's all different kinds. You have your true weasel, but then you have your mink.
Fisher?
You have fisher. You don't have pine marten in this area, but skunks, possums. Chickens are awesome eating. Oh, yeah. No, I will, I live by a farm, and I'll go out, and they have their chickens nice and secure, and they'll have a little teeny gap, and then there's feathers everywhere. Birds of prey, I mean anything. Without more evidence, without scat, who knows? Anything. Everything likes chickens.
What does bear scat look like?
It's off often kind of big, and it depends on what their diet is. So it can be full of seeds, you know, bigger than a dog, sometimes watery, and it just kind of like makes
like,
a...
Is it like a...
Yeah.
Not really formed?
No, it can be formed and still a...
Okay.
A formed pile of poop, and you're like, wow, that's a bear. I've seen it on Gunstock Mountain during grape season. They love grapes. Lots of animals love grapes. Coyotes will eat grapes too. They'll definitely get up there and eat grapes. Blueberry season, you see lots of, I guess I saw some bear, I don't know, I was kind of like, I'm not staying here too long, because it was getting dark when I was by myself again, so. And again, human-animal interactions, it's okay to watch from a distance, to actually be careless and step into a feeding territory of any animal. I don't recommend it. I don't think anyone from Fish and Game would really recommend it either. I don't think they really store it, but I think they'll a little bit.
Because when we found the deer carcass, well, I did, and with my dog, and I wanted to go back the next day with a friend without the dogs, just to see, and it was gone.
I just kind of did it's creepy, but you just stated it, so it was okay, I'll say it. I had a full deer carcass, and I wanted to kind of just take a mental note on how long it took for it to disappear. And I knew the habitat. It was by a pond with a huge coyote and bobcat population. Unbelievable. 3 days later, it was completely gone. 100 plus pound deer, completely gone. And I wish I had set up a game. I wish I had a game camera, but I wish I had set one up too. And I know for sure that it was the bobcat and the coyotes that came and carried it away. Possibly a rare otter was there also. We got a nice otter slide. So. If a bear saw it, absolutely, they would come and they would take a piece and walk away too. But, you know, everything else will too. Things will devour our carcass.
There was bear scat and then coyote fur too.
Yep.
Both was there, but it was like, where did it go? I couldn't
they're not like us. They don't need to eat 3 meals a day. They need to eat one really big, high fat, high nutrient meal. Every so often, and then they can graze and get their berries in their grasses. But yeah, they'll take a chunk and they'll eat quite a bit. Some of you guys heard that I'm one of the fortunate ones. As stewards, we don't get to participate in any hands-on bear experience. You know, we'll never be asked to go help in a nuisance bear situation. We'll never be asked to help in a relocation, and we'll never be able to go out where they rehab. But when I was in my early 20s, I worked for, there used to be a zoo in Greenville, New Hampshire, and we had bear cubs, and I had the amazing opportunity to work for about a month with a whole bunch of animals, including bear cubs. And it was funny because at the time, I thought they were obnoxious, but they were just incredibly playful, curious, amazing critters. I mean, all they wanted to do was play. They wanted to play with you, climb on. You wanted to bring their water out, and they wanted to play in the water. So they'd be trying to carry some buckets of water, and they'd be trying to get in the bucket. Or, you know, you had to clean up their scat, whatever you want to call it. And you'd be taking the shovel, and then you'd want to be playing on the shovel. Or you'd want to have one on each end, and then you'd want to be hanging and climbing. So that was a pretty great experience.
So what are stewards?
Stewards. Stewards and docents are trained from Fish and Game. We're all volunteers. And, you know, some pretty general prerequisites. They do a quick background check to make sure that you're not a felon. If you have a misdemeanor or a Fish and Game violation, they want to know about it. It's got to be a 7-year clearance. And once a year, they give you training. The docents go into the schools and teach about watersheds and fish and a couple of different other habitats. And then the stewards come in, and right now we have 3 modules. We have the bear, bobcat, and brook trout. And you sit down for 40 to 80 hours of classroom time, and they teach you about all this, and then you do just this. You're able to volunteer and go all over the state and teach classes. So I just became a volunteer with a fishing program. It's called Let's Go Fishing. And I started that in late December and January. And I've gone through the docents, the stewards. I'm a search and rescue now, and I will be a hunter's instructor. And I love it. So if you have the time, I can give you the contact information afterwards. And
cool.
7:30.
We very much appreciate all of your training. That was a wonderful
Thank
program.
You.
Thanks very much, Brenda.
Thanks, guys. And again, I have some books in the back, and I will stand now in the back. Let's adjust the camera off.